Thank you all. Thank you to Haider for the invitation. It is a great privilege to be here. Syria is a place very, very dear to my heart. I lived there for several years. I have friends that I consider like family in Syria. So the opportunity to talk about Syria is always a privilege to me. I want to make this a teeny tiny bit interactive. So what I'd like to ask you before we get started is if you have a notebook, if you can pull it out, and a pen. If you don't have a notebook, you should all have your little flyers. That should be enough space to write on. And so pull out a pen anyway. Okay. And I don't know how many of you would be familiar with the map of the Middle East. That's a map of the world. That's us, right about there. Does that sound familiar? Okay. Now, the Middle East is where that box is, and so that's what this big picture here is. Syria is the country in red, and it is on the Mediterranean Sea. It has beautiful coastlines that border the Mediterranean Sea. It's all rocky crevices, and then there's mountains there, and then the rest of that all is desert. It borders there Lebanon, which Lebanon was in civil war for about 16 years. That ended about 20 years ago now, and they're still in the process of rebuilding. Turkey on the north. Turkey's a fantastic country. It's an awesome tourist destination if you're ever looking for a place to go. Iraq, which was invaded by the United States and a coalition that was led by the US military in 2003 and ever since hasn't really been stable. Jordan, which is a very stable country. It's a kingdom, actually, still led by a king. And then in this little corner, Israel, which Syria is officially at war with. So that's where Syria is on a map. And just to kind of put things in perspective, Syria is approximately 10 hours drive from that end to that end, which is, if any of you have ever driven to the north end of Scotland, I think it's about the same distance. So that gives you a sense of how big the country is. It is, however, population-wise, quite a bit smaller than the UK, 22 million people, and we have 60 million here in the UK. Okay, so that's Syria. Welcome to Syria. Now, what I'd like you to do on your sheet of paper, just take 30 seconds, any words that come to mind when you think of Syria. They can be love, hate, war, peace, weird name for a country, and any word that comes to mind, just jot it down. Okay, I'm not going to put anybody on the spot to ask you what words you wrote down. I'm just going to give you the benefit of the doubt in faith that you did it. And now I'm going to show a video, and this video is the Syria that I know, the Syria that I know and love, the Syria that I lived in. So hopefully technology will be quick and we can watch the video. Words that you hadn't thought of before that this video made you think of. Okay. Did anybody have any different words after the video than before the video? I hear a couple of yes. Just maybe nod your head a little bit if yes and shake your head a little bit if no. So everybody's head should either be doing this or this. Okay, we have a few enthusiastic yeses, a few people who think that's a little embarrassing, but that's okay. Okay, this is my list. These are the words that I think of when I think of Syria. Beauty, passion, romance, innocence, glory, inspiration, hope. These are not the words that I see when the media talks about, when I see news articles about Syria. I don't see any of these words popping up. But this is the Syria that I know, and that what I'd like you to leave here today with is just a little hint of why Syria might be a country that it might be interesting to follow a little bit more closely, because who doesn't want to be surrounded by beauty, passion, romance, innocence, glory, inspiration, and hope? Those are good things in life. And that's the Syria that I know, and that's the Syria that I really hope is going to exist again soon. So just a bit of background. In Syria, before 2011, the president of Syria, you may have heard this name knocked around if you ever watched the news on TV, is Bashar al-Assad. He became president in the year 2000. When he became president, he was replacing his father, named Hafez al-Assad, who had been the president for 35 years. So in a sense, you could say he's almost like a king instead of a president because he inherited the leadership of the country from his family. Bashar al-Assad is, he was born and raised in Syria. He went to university in Syria and studied medicine. But when he graduated, he actually moved here to the UK because he wanted to be an eye doctor. He had absolutely no interest in politics. He wanted to study to become an eye doctor, an eye surgeon, and then I think he wasn't sure whether he would stay in the UK or go back to Syria. While here in the UK, he met the woman that is his wife, who is actually British, who her parents are Syrian, but she's British, Asma al-Assad. Then in the mid-1990s, when his father was kind of getting old, that's when he got summoned back to Syria and asked if he would begin to prepare to take over. But if you do hear the name Bashar al-Assad, the way he's described now usually is as a dictator, as the leader of this terrible regime and army. All of those things may be true now, but just a little bit of history that wasn't true 10, 15 years ago. He was an eye doctor. He was someone that you might want doing surgery on your eyes, because eye surgery is a really great thing. I did it a few years ago, but that's completely beside the point. Before 2011, Syria had one of the lowest crime rates in the world. It was literally one of the safest places in the world you could go to. I had the privilege of doing a project with members of parliament in Syria, and one evening, a woman member of parliament gave me a lift to a coffee shop to meet a friend. And if you can probably tell from my accent, I have strong ties to the United States. And so I told her, I said, look, I'm going to be traveling to the United States in a few weeks. The United States, and this was before the conflict, the United States doesn't like Syria very much. In fact, there's always been tension between the U.S. and Syria. What can I say to my American friends that might make them hate Syria a little bit less? And she said, look around you. Do you see anybody sleeping on the streets? Do you see anybody poor? Do you see anybody hungry? Do you see anybody without water to drink? Do you see any crime, any robberies, any assaults? Yeah, we might rule people with an iron fist. There may be no freedom in Syria, but people live a good life. There's a low crime rate. It's a very safe place to be. Approximately 93% of children completed primary education. That's actually a really, really, really good number. That means that they've got at least a sixth grade and are considered able to read and write. This was all paid for by the government. It was celebrated for a place where people of different religions could live together. I am a Christian, and I had some very good Muslim friends, and it was really great fun seeing them try to matchmake me with their Muslim neighbors, or sorry, with their Christian neighbors, because that idea of we can respect each other's religion and live next to each other was very important to them. So they thought it was the funnest thing in the world to have a Christian girl stay with them and make that a way of bonding better with their Christian neighbors. Almost all children were vaccinated against all the major diseases like polio. Again, all funded by the government. Syria took in refugees from other countries. From 2006 to 2008, it's estimated that 2 million Iraqis came from Iraq to Syria seeking refuge. and it had growing popularity as a tourist destination, which is why the video that I just showed you was actually made to promote tourism in Syria. And it was getting a lot of popularity. A lot of people were beginning to put Syria on the list of countries they wanted to visit. This is a typical market, which we call a souk, in the city of Homs. There's one in every major city in Syria. Now, I want you to look at this picture and imagine all of the shops. Each of these gratings represents a shop. Imagine that each one of these shops is open. One shop has scarves in it. One shop has dishes for the house in it. One shop has dresses for women to wear. One shop has some other clothing item. One shop has musical instruments. And there's a man standing in every shop shouting to the people passing by to come buy their wares. They're shouting out deals. They're saying, this is a really good deal. This is a really good price. Beautiful quality. You can see women. You see women with big shopping bags, families wandering together, maybe children with their ice cream. Can you picture that? That's what it used to be like. Now, each of those holes that you see, that's a bullet hole. Okay, this is the city of Homs, which is practically uninhabited now. The people still there are still living under siege today. And each one of those holes there is a bullet hole. And each of that is where a bomb fell. Nobody's shopping in Syria anymore. And this all started in March 2011. What happened in March 2011, you'll hear different stories from different people. So if somebody else tells you another story, don't say, oh, that Dr. Catherine Kraft doesn't know anything, because you'll hear different stories from different people. But here's the way I tell the story. There were some college students, I'm guessing roughly around your age, who had heard that there were some protests going on in Egypt, in Libya, in Tunisia. And they got really excited. They thought, oh, protests, we can go out on the streets, we can chant slogans for freedom, that'll be great fun, we can talk about what we really believe in. And so these kids went to their school, and they wrote graffiti on the wall of their school, and the graffiti said something against the Syrian government. Now that's not something that has ever been done successfully in Syria before, and it was not done successfully this time either. Rather than being called in to somebody's office and disciplined by the school, they were actually arrested. And one boy was, in particular, arrested, taken away, and tortured for about 40 days. Now, he had an older brother who found out about this, and that older brother got his friends together and said, this is not okay. In Egypt, in Libya, in Tunisia, they're toppling governments. Why are we going to stand by and watch my little brother get tortured? So he brought his friends out to the street, and they walked outside the school, and they started protesting peacefully for the release of this boy. And then what happened is the military, the police came, and they actually shot down the protesters. Now this inspired new protesters in other cities who started doing the same thing. But the police did the same thing again. And then what happened is a few members of the Syrian military defected. They said, I don't want to work for a military that's shooting down innocent protesters. And they created a new army, which is called the Free Syrian Army. But they weren't organized. They didn't have a leadership. So when you hear the phrase Free Syrian Army, which is also tossed around a lot these days in the news, it actually means a lot of different organizations, each kind of led by some different militia leader who probably used to work for the Syrian army. And so what ended up happening was it became chaotic. There were different people fighting against different people in different places. And after about a year, this became an opportunity for militant Islamists to come in and start kind of creating a more Islamic state, which, if you remember I mentioned before, Syria was all about religious tolerance. So this is something that makes a lot of people nervous. So that's basically that chaos of different groups fighting against each other is what has resulted today. More than 100,000 people have been killed. Now, most of these people are men fighting in the war, but there are also a lot of innocent, a lot of civilians, a lot of children who have also been killed. Approximately 6 million people, and that's a low estimate, have fled their homes. In fact, I think it's probably more like 6.5 or 7. And if you remember, it's a country of 22 million people. And if you're good at your maths, you know that means 1 in every 3 Syrians no longer lives in their house. 2 million, and again, this is a low number, but the official numbers are always low, have fled the country, are living in Jordan, in Lebanon, in Turkey, in Iraq, all the countries that neighbor Syria. So that's, again, 1 in every 10 people has left the country, and every day, hundreds are leaving. More than 1 million, or more than half of the people who have fled the country, are children. They're not grown-ups, they're not involved in the conflict in any way. but they had to leave. 90% of Syrian children, remember before 93% of children finished primary school, now 90% of children aren't in school at all, okay? Their schools have shut down, their schools have become a shelter for people who had to flee their house, their schools have been bombed down, the teachers left until there was no one left to teach them. For one reason or another, now only 10% of the children in Syria go to school. More than half the hospitals have been destroyed or are pretty much useless. So most people are no longer accessing health care of any sort. Okay? So what I'm going to do now for the next 10, 15 minutes, I have a number of different pictures, and I'm going to tell you the story behind those pictures. But then I do want to make sure that at the end we have some time to hear from you, to get questions or any comments that you have. Okay. This picture was taken in August of this past year, of 2013. This river here separates Syria and Iraq. So what you're looking at back there is Syria. What you're looking at here is Iraq. Because Iraq is a country that has fought its own civil war for the last decade, they were very hesitant to let Syrian refugees in. And so for about 3 months, they kept the border completely closed, and Syrians weren't allowed to cross over. This is the day they opened the border. Look how many people are crossing. We're just waiting on the Syrian side for a chance to get into Iraq. I was there actually the week before this, and I had the chance to meet one young Syrian man who was able to cross before they closed the border the first time. And he'd come from Damascus, which is way at the other end. So it's a 10-hour drive away from where this border stands. And I asked him, first of all, why did you come from Damascus? And second of all, why are you here alone? Don't you have a mother, brothers, sisters? He said, yeah, I did come alone. I did come all this way because this is the safest place for me. And I left my mother and brother and sisters in Damascus, and I came by myself because if I stayed any longer, I was going to be recruited into the military. I'd have to take a side in this war. I would either have to fight for the Syrian government or I would have to fight for one of the militias. So my mom decided, I didn't want to fight, my mom didn't want me to fight, so I came to Iraq. And she's staying, she's still in the middle of the conflict, but she doesn't want her son to have to fight. This is a picture of Jordan, of Zaatari camp in Jordan. It's about 5 miles away from the Syrian border, which is, well, it would be up there somewhere, the Syrian border. It's a camp that was built into the desert. It opened in August 2012, so a year and a half ago. So before that, don't imagine there were absolutely no buildings. It was just all sand, okay? That's what this area was like before. And then they built a certain number of tents, and then they had to keep building tents. The United Nations, so the international community, provided all the tents. And then over the course of the last year, governments from the Gulf, principally the Saudi Arabian and the Qatari governments, have been providing what they call caravanat. They're basically like, you know, the back of a lorry, which you can kind of set up. It's like a big square metal thing. And so that's what most people are living in. This is now the fifth largest city in Jordan. There's 150,000 Syrians living here. You're not allowed out. You're only allowed in if you come in through the Jordanian or the Syrian border. They have trucks at the border which bring people to the camp. If you're Syrian and you're in the camp, you can't go out. They have set up stores because Syrians are pretty industrious people, so they set up stores to buy and sell things, and they use Syrian money in these stores. The only way you can get out is if you're Jordanian or you have a Jordanian who sponsors you to go live with him. This is great in a sense because you have everything provided. People living in this camp have this tent or the caravanat to live in. They have food provided by the World Food Program. They have schools set up by the Qatari government and the Jordanian government. They've got everything they need except their freedom and except opportunities. So when I was there a few months ago, I met a few people around 20 years of age, and they said, I am desperate to get off the camp because it's time for me to start university, but I can't go to university. So if I can't go to university, I want a job. But there are no jobs in the camp. So they were desperate to get out, not because life was awful, they were under shelling, but just because what kind of a life is it to just sit and wait for the war in their country to end? Now this picture is taken inside Syria. This is a family in a village in the north of Syria. They have not left their home. They're still living at home. However, living at home is maybe a little bit different than it used to be. For example, these kids, they have these swings that they probably brought in from a local fun park, which no longer operates, and they bring it into their courtyard, so they play there. But that's not all they do for fun. They also go out and they play in the rubble. They play fort, but in piles of buildings that have been bombed out. They collect bullet casings as a hobby. That's what they do for fun. They don't have electricity. They would have previously had electricity, but they don't anymore. They don't go to school. Some days they eat, sometimes they don't. But they're waiting. Now, who controls this area? Is it the Syrian regime or the Syrian government? Or is it the Free Syrian Army, a certain group? Is it the Islamists? That really decides a lot for them, because if they're under the Syrian government, the school is probably going to reopen soon. If it's under the Free Syrian Army, it depends on what the NGOs are able to do. If it's under the Islamists, maybe there's a Quranic school, but not a school that teaches them history or maths. This is also taken inside Syria. I think this photo is really fun because there's a lot of groups of young Syrians who have decided to stay. They have no interest in leaving. They're not fighting either. In this city, I know of a group of men. Have any of you heard of capoeira? It's a Brazilian martial arts dance thing. Okay, I'm prepared to do my demonstration for you, where you have to do like this, and then you like kick over and stuff. It's great fun. And it's been found to be very effective with children who have been through trauma to help them process things. So a group of young men have stayed in this city, which is pretty much completely under siege and being fought over by a few different militias, so that they can work with groups of kids doing capoeira. So they've gotten these groups of 30 kids together who aren't in school, whose family members may or may not still be around, who may or may not be in their homes, and they're getting them together to do social activities. They could leave. These guys, they have connections, but they don't want to leave. They want to help. I met other men like this, other young men who kind of stayed in their community, which the only people who stayed in the community were the ones who had nowhere else to go. They didn't even have enough money to pay like the 10 pence it would have cost them to get to another neighborhood. They have no food, they have nothing. The whole neighborhood has been bombed out, but they're living in kind of the old shells of the houses. Now these are young university students, and they said, "We're not leaving. This is really sad. This is my neighborhood. I love my neighborhood. I don't want to give up on it." And so they've gotten together, and they were able to get a little bit of funding so that they could buy like carts, rubbish bins, and some shovels. And they started walking up and down the streets because they said, "Life here in this neighborhood, it's really miserable right now. But we want people to still have some dignity. So the government trash collectors, they don't come here anymore. We're going to do it ourselves." And so they stayed in their neighborhood and walked up and down the streets, picking up rubbish from the streets, trying to make the streets look nicer. And these families, these really destitute, poor families, looked out their windows and they saw these young men walking up and down the streets picking up trash. And they said, "Wow, that's my neighbor's son. He was a university student. Why is he picking up the trash?" And what they ended up doing is they came out and they started picking up the trash too. And they all started walking together. And it's just beautiful to see how an entire community of people who have nothing left to live for have taken so much pride in making their neighborhood look beautiful again.